an unusual word in that we don't normally use it in our day-to-day language, in our vernacular. I mean, we don't go around talking about propitiation. And let's not limit it to theology. It's not just a theological word. It's a Bible word. It's a good word. And of course, we want to see what it is the Bible has to say about it. There is, of course, a dictionary definition. There's the theological definition. But we want the Bible definition. There is the pagan concept of propitiation, which simply means that a pagan would offer up a gift to his or her God for the purpose of appeasing that God. That's bribery. And, you know, unfortunately, people today think that that's how you relate to God Almighty. We go around living lives of goodness, in effect, to pay God off. We're paying him a bribe. Do good things so that will make God happy or keep him happy or you win his favor. And that's just anathema. That's just a disgrace to what God has done on our behalf by way of sacrifice. If God expected you to pay him off, to pay a bribe, to maintain his favor, then doesn't that demean the ultimate work of Jesus Christ on the cross? Think about that for just a second. What would the point have been for the Lord Jesus to die such a violent, cruel death at the hands of an offended father? If ultimately God says, but you know what, you just go ahead and do your best and then maybe it'll work, you know, and maybe See, Paul talks about the offense of the cross. Paul talks about, listen, if circumcision meant anything, you know, why am I suffering? You know, the cross is the final answer to man's sin problem. Man has to learn you're not part of the equation. And that's what bugs humanity quite a bit. Yeah, again, that man wants to be part of the equation, and God declares on that altar, you're not part of the equation. Other than the work is done, and now God extends the free gift. Not a cheap gift, it's a free gift because he paid that tremendous cost to save us, okay? So, we're going to kind of develop it a little bit more. Again, I don't want the doctrine of propitiation to be cold, dry theology. We're not just going to look at the mechanics, though we'll refer to it. I want your soul to be touched because all the sins I've ever committed, am committing, and will commit. That's why he did it. And man, that should touch you in such a way that you look at life completely different, okay? So here's the passage, Romans chapter 3, let's read verse 24 and verse 25. Verse 24 of Romans chapter 3, being justified. You know, if there's any verse that every one of us should know by heart, this is a beautiful verse, isn't it? Being justified freely by his grace through, hey, you see, it's because of somebody else, by the way. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Now, verse 25 is what we're going to focus on. Whom God hath set forth. We'll say something else about that idea of setting it forth. God puts it out on open public display. No mystery to it. No secret involved. No hidden information. It's supposed to be simple. It's supposed to be it is understandable. It's knowable. You know, we talk about why is there so much confusion about how do you get to heaven? And you got all of these different theological denominational systems that'll give you all sorts of explanations of what it takes to get. And God is saying, listen, I am showing you how you can have eternal life. It's God who set forth. Of course, to be, by the way, whom, Jesus Christ, God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood. There's that word, propitiation, okay? And we'll go back to Isaiah 53. That word, propitiation, going back to Hebrews. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 9, And again, we won't develop it, but here we have a word in verse 5, Hebrews chapter 9, and notice verse 5. And over it, reference to the Ark of the Covenant, okay? The Ark of the Covenant located in the Holy of Holies, which was part of the holy place, which was part of the tabernacle. We got to go back to Israel's history and understand that God had a dwelling place. If you asked, where's God about 3,000 years ago, 3,500 years ago, there was a physical structure that was the centerpiece of Israel's national identity. It was called the tabernacle, made out of skins. And within that tabernacle, there were a couple of compartments. There were a couple of items that symbolized and typified some things. There was a holy of holies. There was a room that no one was allowed to enter, called the Holy of Holies. And in that Holy of Holies, there was an ark. We can call it a coffin if you'd like. And inside of this ark, there were a number of little, you had the Aaron's rod that budded, you had manna, and you had the tablets and so forth. And upon this coffin was a lid. And that lid had two cherubim and the wings extending out, protecting the integrity, the holiness, and the righteousness of Almighty God. And verse 5 now, and over it, that ark, the cherubims of glory. Remember what Romans tells us. All have sinned and come short of the glory. You know, that's why no one was allowed in that room. No one had access to Almighty God. No one could just walk in and say, hey, Jehovah, I feel like just, chatting a little bit. Unless you wanted to die in instantaneous death. Over it, the cherubims of glory, shadowing, but notice what God calls this, the mercy seat. Listen, God, Israel, as the Lord is communicating, teaching, revealing, educating Israel, and all of these types and shadows and symbols, which ultimately has its reality at the coming of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, by the way. God tells Israel, you see that lid on top of that ark, that vessel, that container. That's where there's a lid on top of the container. What does God call that lid? He calls it a mercy seat. You know what you need? You need a merciful God. Don't demand justice. Don't demand mercy. And God is educating Israel, saying, listen, I should destroy you because of your continual, consistent rebellion and disobedience and so on and so forth. But you know what? There is only one way that God and His righteousness and His offended justice could continue to relate to His rebellious people. And that's because God is a merciful God. But remember that mercy is never built upon flimsy sentimentality, as I said that last Sunday. The idea, I'll be merciful to you because I like you and I want to cut you a break. And so that's how God operates. God is righteous. God has to have a legal basis upon which He can extend mercy to the undeserving. And that's what Romans 3 is all about. Remember this whole legal represent this whole legal treatise, this whole legal courtroom scene, God doing it the right way, not just excusing our sin, not just sweeping our sin under the rug. God doesn't overlook it. God says, if I love you, I got to deal with this. So the mercy seat has to have a basis, a legal basis upon which God could not execute wrath. So where there's a mercy seat, you see the word mercy seat? That's the Greek word from which Romans 3:25 we find propitiation. So we got to understand something here. When we we'll go back to Leviticus for just a second here. There is a tremendous type when you look at the Holy of Holies. Oh, and we're going to look back there in Leviticus 16. Only one individual was allowed into the Holy of Holies once a year. He's called the high priest. You know what Hebrews is going to develop? Who's the ultimate high priest as far as Israel's concerned? Guess who? Jesus Christ. And all of this picture, this imagery, okay? When we start looking at the accomplishments of Calvary, God says, that's my propitiation. Go back to history. And God says, Israel, you bring the blood of what? Animals. You see, if God's going to be merciful to anybody, it's going to require blood. Somebody has to die. Why a bullock? Why a goat? What did they ever do? Nothing. Aren't they innocent? Now we begin to see the typology. Jesus is called the Lamb of God, the innocent one. And God, through Israel's history, starts communicating various doctrines, which Paul, he kind of bundles it all together. There's some issues here regarding the doctrine of imputation, the doctrine of identification, and the doctrine of substitution. God says, you take that innocent animal, and you cut its throat, and you drain its blood. And you tell that high priest on the Day of Atonement, he is allowed to walk in behind that monster curtain that divided God from all of sinful Israel. And you tell that priest, you collect some of that animal blood, and you pull back that curtain. And by the way, I already mentioned there's incense, and the incense filled that Holy of Holies with smoke. It was hard to see. And then you tell that priest, you walk in and you sprinkle seven times, not six or you die, not eight or what? And you think, wow, God's pretty harsh. No, the law is pretty harsh, isn't it? If the law says seven and you say, well, I'm going to do it six, aren't you guilty of breaking the law? I say, you know what, I think I'm only going to do it once. Remember that poor guy, remember the ark? God says, anybody touches that ark, what happens? You die. And remember this poor soldier. He meant well. He was sincere. And remember the cattle and the ox, the ark was, and the ark started to tip over. And you know what my reaction would have been? We can't let this ark fall to the ground. So what did the soldier do? He grabbed it. And what happened? Dead. You think, what kind of a God is that? You don't think God could have prevented his ark from hitting the ground? You see, I know it sounds cruel, but God said don't touch it. Why? The law. Listen, the law ain't going to cut you a break. That isn't how the law is designed. And you know, if you transgress the law one time, you're guilty of them all. And you did, and you have violated the law, by the way. You ever have a bad attitude? You ever lie? You're guilty. You're guilty, okay? So God says seven times. So you take that blood and you sprinkle it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then you take that goat. And there's two goats involved. We'll go back there. And you transfer the sins of the nation of Israel upon that goat. And then you release it out into the wilderness. You dismiss it out into the wilderness, never to be seen ever again. And you think, wait a minute, in representation and type, all of the sins of the nation of Israel is imputed upon that old goat. And the goat is gone, never to be remembered ever again. That mercy seat, again, that word propitiation, that's the concept that Paul is developing here in Romans chapter 3. And we have to know something, that when we look at the accomplishments of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, he is the ultimate reality of the shadows and types of the Old Testament. Since we're in the book of Hebrews, again, verse 5 talks about that mercy seat. Drop down to verse 11, all right? Hebrews 9, verse 11. But Christ. Now, Hebrews, by the way, is written to who? Hebrews. And so the writer of Hebrews, whom we do not know. So let's stop with all of the speculation. I mean, there are people that hate each other's guts. I shouldn't say hate each other, but they don't like each other. Because there's a camp that says Paul wrote it, and I don't think Paul wrote it. And now all of a sudden you're, you know, it doesn't tell us who wrote it, and that's okay. Well, obviously it does tell us who wrote it. Who wrote the book of Hebrews? God. Who? Okay, that's the issue. Anyway, Hebrews is written to communicate and to reveal to the nation of Israel the realities of the cross, by the way, as the basis and foundation of the new covenant, okay? And so drop down to verse 11, but Christ being come and a high priest, again, you got to go back to Israel's history, and we're going to go there, Leviticus 16, in just a moment. A high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect, a what? A tabernacle? Hey, that goes right back to Israel's history. Only what tabernacle did Jesus have? Flesh, blood, sinew, cells, you know? And the tabernacle in the Old Testament, it was made out of animal skins, a temporary dwelling place. God had an address. It's called the tabernacle. Jesus is the ultimate tabernacle. And wasn't the one, didn't Jesus say, hey, who asked the question, show me, hey, we want to see your Father. We want to see God. And what did Jesus say? I've been so long with you. Don't you know when you see me, you've seen who? Didn't he say, I and the Father are one? We're one. You know where the dwelling place of Almighty God was during the messianic ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ? There he, right there, Jesus Christ was the dwelling place of Almighty God. Emmanuel, God with us in the flesh. So again, Hebrews is saying, remember all of that typology back there? Jesus Christ is the reality of it all, right? You have the image, but now you have the substance, okay? So Jesus, he's not only the high priest, but he comes by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Verse 12, neither by the blood of what? Day of Atonement, a goat, and calves. High priest had to slaughter a bullock, a calf, to atone for his own sins, but by his own blood. Wait a minute. Now we're talking about propitiation here. His own blood he entered in once. How often did the high priest of the nation of Israel have to go into that tabernacle? Every year. Why? Because as soon as he sprinkled the blood on the mercy seat and he walked out into the camp, guess what? The records are tabulating all of the sin. You know, can you imagine every sin of the nation of Israel recorded, preserved, tabulated, and now you have this monster. Boy, I mean, if they were writing it down, I mean, how many volumes would it take? And so the guess what? After 365 days, you got to do it again. As soon as you walk down, all of the sins are being tabulated. You see the accumulating of sins. You had to keep shedding blood. You had to keep sprinkling blood. Why? Because Israel, you guys, you as a nation, keep sinning. So now we have Jesus Christ. He enters in once into the holy place. And look what the writer's having obtained. Eternal. That's what Israel desperately needs. Not this perpetuation, this continuing offering. We sin, we got to pay for it. We sin, we got to pay for it. Jesus says, I'm going to pay for it once and for all forever. Verse 13, for if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified through the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood? The blood, and we're not going to even deal with, but see, there's a lot of arguments sometimes in theology about blood. Was it really necessary for Jesus to shed his blood? You know, it wasn't really the blood. It was his death. It was the blood that ripped it. Listen, Hebrews keeps talking about the what? Blood, because where's the life? Life is in the blood. Jesus had to shed his blood, just like the innocents. God didn't say just kill it and throw the carcass on the mercy seat. God says, you kill it, you drain the blood, and I want the blood. I don't want the animal. I want the blood. Okay? How much more, verse 14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself, propitiation, without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works, and to serve the living God. Now, verse 19, of course, tells us that, hey, this is the basis for the new covenant. Drop down to verse 22. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without shedding of blood is what? no remission. Verse 25, nor yet that he should offer himself oft as the high priest entered in the holy place every year with blood of others. It's not what Jesus, verse 26, for then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. I don't know how, I don't want to just beat a dead horse, but your eternal life hinges and is built upon this truth. It requires sacrifice. Somebody sacrificed for your sins. And it better be a perfect one-time eternal sacrifice. And God says, I'll provide it. I'll provide it. Propitiation has everything to do with God who, in love, he saw our desperate, pathetic predicament. He saw how it is we should all burn in a literal lake of fire forever because he is that holy. He's that holy. Right? Holy, holy, holy. But God who is love. By the way, you notice 1 John doesn't say God felt love. He is love. And you know what love is. It's an act of the will. You know that God, he intelligently, willfully made a decision. He chose to do something for those that do not deserve it. In fact, when we were without strength, when we were ungodly, God commended his love toward us in that while we were what? Yet we're going around enjoying it while we were enemies. God says, I'm going to show you how much I love you. I'm going to ascribe worth to the worthless. I'm going to ascribe value to the valueless. I'm going to do something on your behalf because you just can never do it. You can't bribe God. You can't bribe me. You can't do anything to appease me. God says, you can't do anything to earn my favor. I mean, that chasm between a righteous and holy God is so wide. Hopeless, isn't it? It is absolutely hopeless. That is right. Hopeless without God. Thank God he's a merciful God because this is what God did in his mercy. Not cutting anybody breaks. He says, I will provide the ultimate payment for every one of your sins. Propitiation has everything to do with God as the sole source for your redemption. All right? Again, don't you pollute. Don't you participate, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. Again, not of works. God says, I am the only source for man's eternal redemption. He didn't say, hey, I need you to help me. Charlotte, I need you to help me. God says, stay away. Don't put your filthy hands on what I'm about to do for you. God is the sole source who takes his son and in effect says, son, you are going to be that one-time eternal sacrifice and substitute for the sins of a worthless humanity. And you, my dear son, will be the ultimate eternal appeasement and satisfaction for my offended justice. There's a transaction between father and son. And be thankful, we're cut out. We're cut out of this, okay? And wow, we know and the son says, Dad, are you kidding me? You want me to die for Paul? Alex? Do you understand what these guys do during the course of the day? The attitudes, the thinking processes, the behaviors. And the father says, son, I love them. And the son says, Dad, you love them that much? I'll love those that you choose to love. Now, let's be so thankful that the Son willingly said, I will make myself no reputation, and I will take upon me the glorious second person of the Godhead, and I will become a servant, and I'll be made in the likeness of men. And Hebrews says, a body hast thou prepared for me, and I will be obedient to you, my Father, and I will be obedient unto, not martyrdom, not an unjust, I will be obedient unto death, even the death of the what? The specific altar of death. Dad, I'm going to love what you love. I'll value what you value. I will ascribe worth to those you ascribe worth. Transaction between Father and Son. And the Son says, Dad, I with great joy will participate in your wise eternal plan for redemption of all humanity. Father, it's between me and you. And the Father says, yeah, Son, it's between you and me. Are you going to do it? The Son says, I'll do it. The Son comes into the ghettos of humanity. And he by faith lives, the faith of Christ. Remember we talked about the faith of Christ? And he by faith says, Dad, I know who I am. I know what I'm here for. I know what I'm going to do. I know my mission. I know my goal. I know. Oh, Dad. If this cup would pass. You see that? See the reality of this? If this cup would pass, nevertheless, not my will be done, Dad. Dad, I know what your ultimate will is. You want to save these creeps. You want to save these worms. You want to save them? That's your will? Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah 53. And here is the Bible definition for propitiation, okay? Isaiah 53. Again, stay out of this, please. Stay out. And, you know, isn't it such a wonderful God who says, hey, just stand by the sideline, look at what I'm doing, and just rejoice in what I did for you. Just rejoice, okay? Just say thank you. That's all God wants. Just say thank you. Isn't that, you know, as a parent, you know, sometimes I look at my kids and just say thank you, right? You know what? Okay, just say thanks. Right? And, you know, I don't want to ask for anything. Can you at least say thanks, you know? And what a gracious, that's grace. You see, grace, no conditions, no strings, no prerequisites, no prior conditions. It's all God doing it for us. And that's all we, thank God. What else can we do? Isaiah 53, verse 10. Yet, and here we go, it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make, now there's the doctrine of imputation. God the Father, he shall make, there's a transformation that's taking place. He shall make his soul an offering. Who is God offering his Son up to? Himself. God is saving humanity from God. You think, what? Salvation has to do with God saving you from God. From his wrath and justice and righteousness. And God says, listen, I'm gonna make my Son an offering. And I'm the one that's going to put him on that coffin lid. I'm the one that's going to put him on the mercy seat, because the legal basis upon which God could ever be merciful requires the shedding blood of the innocent. And God says, I'll tell you what, I'm going to put him on that cross. I'm going to do it. And I'm going to make his soul an offering, because it's God who's seeking the eternal answer to his offended justice. God says, I'm doing it for me, to appease me. God says, I'm going to do it. I'm going to make his soul an offering for sin. He shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days. And the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Verse 11, he shall see of the travail of his soul. And we're gonna have to look at that. I want to see it. You know that God gives us information? What God sees, you and I can see it, by the way. We're going to see the travail of his soul. Propitiation. When God says, I'm going to see it, he doesn't say that this is... God says, you want to see how my son's soul experienced the agony and the crushing anguish and the violent experience of the death of the wicked? You want to see it? God says, I'm going to show you this. And we're going to see the travail of his soul. Now, look at verse 11. And he shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be, here we go, satisfied. That's propitiation. The all-sufficient, all-satisfying sacrifice that was offered up for my sins. God was, again, what does he take pleasure in? What is he satisfied in? The perfect payment. The payment of the death of the innocent, only it's the death of his own beloved son in whom I am well pleased. God says, that's where I'm satisfied. Sin is now paid for. It's paid for. And if it's paid for, do I owe him anything? No. Grace demands that you don't owe God anything. Now, doesn't that really bother religious people? Wait a minute. You're saying that we shouldn't live lives. Oh, wait a minute. That's not what I said. When it comes to grace, grace excludes what? Grace, by definition, it demands that works are excluded. So if he did it all, is there anything left? Is there anything that God says, now I expect you to fill in the blank? No. God says, look at what I have done. Look at what my son has done. Believe it. That's it. Just believe it. And that's why religion just doesn't like that. Too easy. Too easy. You know, anybody who would make that charge is operating in ignorance. Too easy. I've always said, but how hard do you want it? It's too easy. Okay, how hard do you want it? Yeah, 1 + 1, that's too easy. Okay, then here's a calculus problem. Here's a differential equation. You know, how hard do you want salvation to be? God says, it's going to be simple, but at a tremendous eternal price, right? The concept of propitiation is found, by the way, real quick, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Not 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 5. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. The concept of propitiation, it's sprinkled certainly all over the Word of God. I mean, that's an understatement. But Paul, he makes references to the propitiatory work. Look here, for example, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, okay? 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. Now notice what Paul says, for even Christ... our Passover. Now, you know the concept of the Passover, right? Going back to Israel's history, God says, I'm going to kill y'all. I'm going to kill the firstborn, the angel of death. He's going to walk through the camp, the encampment of Israel. But there's only one way in which anybody would be immune from the death sentence. And what was it? Here we go again. You kill the poor little lamb. Didn't do anything. Cut its throat, drain its blood, and you take that blood and you wipe it upon the doorpost, right? The Passover lamb. Beautiful image, type. But who's the reality of it? The end of verse 7. Even Christ our Passover is, now notice, sacrificed. Sacrifice demands. There's a substitutionary issue. He's sacrificing not for his own sins. He's sacrificing for the sins of others, okay? Of course, Ephesians chapter 5, another verse that should be memorized. Ephesians chapter 5. Let's read verse 1, but verse 2 is the one I want to highlight. Ephesians 5, verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as, dear children. Man, I'm a dear child, you know. Verse 2, and walk in love, and now we have a Bible definition of love, as Christ also loved us and hath given himself for an, you see that word? Offering, again, the imagery back there in Leviticus, an offering and a sacrifice. Sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. The issue of God being pleased, he's satisfied, he's eternally appeased, okay? Now, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we actually have some of the mechanics here, okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and let's look there at verse 21, all right? 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21. For he, God, hath made him, Jesus Christ, to be sin for us. Now, you see the three doctrines again? God, here's a transaction. God made his son. And you know what it means to listen, there is an abnormal transformation that is occurring in the person of Jesus Christ when he's hanging there on that altar of Calvary, all right? The mercy seat of Almighty God, if you will. And this is that abnormal, this is a transformation that is contrary to nature. You talk about illogical. How can this be? In order for me to, God made his son something because he naturally wasn't like this. I mean, Jesus Christ is without sin. Jesus Christ is God where? In flesh. So the Father, in the work of propitiation, in order to be the ultimate fulfillment of the types and shadows of the Old Testament. Listen, that high priest back there in Leviticus 16, he did was grab the head of the goat. And in type, transferred. Listen, now, wait a minute. When that goat ran off into the wilderness, it still had four legs and so on and so forth. It's still blah, 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 blah. It has no clue what's going on, okay? But when Jesus Christ is, he knows what's going on. And he willingly agreed to be a loving participant, okay? He's quite different than that animal. That animal had no say. Yeah, can you imagine the goat saying, wait a minute, I protest here for just a second. But see, Jesus Christ, he didn't protest. He didn't question. He didn't panic. Jesus didn't panic. Now, he sweat drops of blood, did he not? Not because he's panicking, but because of the weight, the full scope of what is going to happen in his soul began to afflict his understanding. I mean, it began to touch him in such a way. So this is an abnormal, it's contrary to nature. God made, and now that's imputation, okay? God made, and verse 21 continues, to be what? Sin. Jesus Christ, he's sin. That's what the verse says, okay? Did I say he sinned? No. But is he sin? There is that moment in time and all in human history for 3 hours. You know what God is saying when he looks there in Israel? There's sin right there. And, you know, here I am jumping up and down saying, no, I'm the one. God doesn't see that. God is not saying, I see sin in you and you and you. You know what God is doing? He is concentrating his laser-like focus, and all God sees there for 3 hours is sin. It isn't what is it, who is it? My son. He is made sin. Doctrine of identification. And you think, well, how can God do that? Didn't God already establish those principles in the Old Testament? He did it over and over and over again. Look at the bullocks. Look at the goats. They are the ones identified with what? Sin. God says, now here's the ultimate reality. My beloved son, that's sin. and you think about Hitler. Mussolini, Stalin, and you Pol Pot, and you think about some of the most cruel, Genghis Khan, and some of the outrageous atrocities that are committed. And you think, wait a minute. God says, that's sin. My son, he is sin. S-I-N. You know, remember when those soldiers they put on top of that cross, they said, King of the Jews, remember that? You know what, in one way, they should have. In fact, Israel, in faith, you know what they should, you know what kind of sign they should have put up there? Sin. And you think, how in the world can you say that about Jesus Christ? I'm not the one that's saying it. God says, there should have been a lit up banner declaring to all humanity, sin, 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 sin. And here's a bloody, pulverized mass of humanity just hanging there, right? The Father says, there he is, sin. But let's, verse 21, for he, God, hath made him, Jesus Christ, to be sin. And what are the next two words? For us. That's the doctrine of substitution. Listen, propitiation, the heart of propitiation, the underpinning of propitiation has everything to do with this transaction that's occurring between Father and Son when the Father says, I will appease my offended wrath, and Son says, I will participate, Father, in faith and in love, and there is this transaction. God, by grace, he offers it up, and the Son says, I love him just as much, and because he's motivated by grace, he allows himself to be identified as sin, and it was all for who? For the ones who committed it. For us. Substitution. What a glorious transaction. Martin Luther called it the great exchange. The great exchange. Go to Psalms chapter 22, all right? I kind of talk too much, don't I? Don't answer that. Castello's back there. Psalms 22. Okay, remember Isaiah 53 says, he shall see the travail of his what? God says, I want you to see what I saw, okay? So we go to Psalms 22, and guess what we actually see? We're seeing what God sees. We're seeing what Jesus Christ sees. Listen, we actually can study the emotional, psychological work and experience. Not Jesus as King of Israel, not Jesus, but Jesus Christ as the sweet-smelling savor, as that offering, as that substitutionary sacrifice. Penal substitution. We get to see the travail of his soul. Why? Listen, I hope it bothers you. It should bother you. It bothers me. Psalms 22, verse 1. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me? Later on, God, you know what God says to his son? In an acceptable time, I'm going to help you. Now, when do you need help? When you're in the midst of trouble, right? When you are in a jam. Listen, if you're stranded on the highway with flat tires and no gas, I need help when? Now. So here's Jesus Christ. Remember, God just made him sin. He is the sacrifice. And here's the Son as he's experiencing this psychological trauma. He says, why aren't you helping me? And in Psalm 69, the Father says, Son, I'm going to help you in an acceptable time. You know that the time for rescue was not then. That isn't the time God the Father is going to help. Now listen, the Father loves his son, right? But the Father says, this is not the time I'm not going to help you. I'm not going to help you. Can you imagine a dad saying that to his son when the son is crying out in agony and anguish. And the father says, not yet. I can't help you yet. Why? Because the payment has to be made in full. The father, in love and grace, refused to help his son, who is crying out for deliverance, and actually says, son, now's not the time. I can't help you. Can you imagine how it must have just crushed the father? But at the same time, the father made him sin. And the offended justice of God now, it has to be executed. My God, why have you forsaken me? Keep your finger here and let's real quick go to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. We need to grasp the import and impact of that statement when the son, crying in anguish, is begging for help. He's begging for help, and the father says, I'm not going to respond. I can't respond, okay? And I'm glad he didn't. Now, that sounds almost cruel. It almost sounds cruel, doesn't it? I'm glad the father didn't help his son, because my sins, my eternal destiny, is hanging in the balance. Doesn't it sound rather cruel? You almost have to be thankful the father wouldn't help his son. But remember, the son willfully chose to participate, okay? And we don't want to take anything away from the son's participation in our eternal redemption, okay? John chapter 8, verse 29, and he that sent me he's with me. The Father hath not left me, what? Wait a minute. When he's hanging there as that bloody offering, what does it mean when he says, my God, why hast thou? I'm alone. I'm abandoned. You know what it meant for the father to forsake his son? The father renounces his son. He repudiates his son. You see, Jesus here in verse 29 describes this eternal prevailing presence that he enjoyed with his father. The father hath not left me alone. But wait a minute. There was a separation there. You know, anybody who's ever had a father abandon them, don't get too worked up, all right? We have here this estrangement that occurs. The one who always enjoyed the prevailing presence of his father, like this. He's never left me alone. What's happening there as that offering hangs? Sin. The father has to abandon him. The father has to separate himself from that eternal connection and attachment and intimacy that he's always had with his son. He had to cut that tie. And a lot more verses. We go back to Psalms 22. Go back to Psalms 22. Why hast thou forsaken me? The father now is renouncing his son. That isn't his son. That sign above the head of Jesus Christ was not Son of God. What is it according to 2 Corinthians 5:21? Sin. Sin. The father who cannot even look upon sin, who is righteously offended by it. He says, you're not my son anymore. You're sin. And now you understand why he's crying? Oh, my God, why? Why are you forsaking me? Why are you, look, what does he say there in verse 1? Why art thou so far from, listen, there isn't even a possibility of rescue. How far is the Father? So far, the Father cannot, will not help his son. He can cry all he wants. Romans 8 says, God who spared not. You mothers, oh, even dads, right? Now, I mean, dads aren't always heartless, a little more heartless. You know, I know how it is. You hear the baby crying in the other room, right? And I always did what I always did. I say, sure, you know, you can. I don't do a good job consoling babies because mom has the, you know, and but you know what a mom does when they hear their baby cry. You know what? Who I won't point anybody at, but you know, you mothers know when it's your baby crying in the nursery, right? You immediately, your ears perk up. And as a mother, if you hear your baby cry, especially when they're in the hands of strangers, I understand. You know, you're sitting in the auditorium and you're, what do you as a mother instinctively, my baby's crying. And what do you want to do? You want to rush. You know, you want to make sure everything okay. Now, I just want you to grasp, here's the father who's hearing the roaring and the crying of his beloved son. And what does the loving father do? Ignores it. He will not respond. He spared not. I can't spare you. Why? Your sin. Your sin. Go to Galatians chapter 3. What does Paul say there in Galatians chapter 3? Oh, I hope propitiation is more than dry theology. Oh, my, we can see the travail of our Savior's soul. And he did it for me. Remember what Paul says regarding Jesus, who loved me and gave himself for who? He did it for me. I can pray to my Father. And I'm personalizing. I'm telling you, personalize it. He did it for me. He did it for me. That will change the way you view your life. It will impact your life like no other truth. Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. And what do we read there? Verse 13. This is an easy 13, not a good number. Galatians 3:13. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a what? By the way, see the word made again? This is unnatural. This is abnormal. This is contrary to the, it defies. Because that's the Father's fault. God's the one who's doing it. I'm not going to spare you, son. I hold you fully accountable for all of the transgressions, iniquities, and sins that were committed since Adam. I'm going to blame you. I'm blaming you. Cry all you want. I'm not going to respond. This verse says he was made a what? A curse. For those of you who've been involved with the class here, you can go back. Don't turn there. Deuteronomy chapter 21. And do you remember, look, Paul quotes Deuteronomy 21. He says, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Now remember why Paul goes to Deuteronomy 21? He goes to Deuteronomy 21 because in Deuteronomy 21, what do you do to a rebellious son? That's the context. Now, all of you youngins, under the law, if you were a rebellious son and you would not respond to your dad had the right to go to the religious elders. And by the way, there was a bit of a history involved. You know, I mean, there was an elaborate system to deal with this. And ultimately, these religious leaders, if they determine that that son is a rebel and he's not responding, he's not submitting to the doctrine, to the leadership, to the headship, to the leadership and so forth, you know what the law demanded? But where would you put that dead carcass? On a tree. Why? So that the nation of Israel would understand, this is what we do to rebellious sons. We kill them. And when it says, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, who's cursing that rebellious son? It's God who says, you dare treat your dad like that? You stone him, you hang him on that tree. And I want all of Israel to understand, I curse him. Why is Paul using that passage to describe Jesus Christ? The Father who set him forth, right? Public, open display. He wants you to understand that I pronounce a curse on sin, on my son. The context is he's a rebellious son. Now, Jesus didn't rebel against the will of his Father, but Jesus, by way of imputation, identification, substitution, he took our place as the rebel. And the Father says, okay, you're cursed. Now, you understand why the Father will not respond, will not help, will not spare his Son. This is violent, isn't it? I mean, this is horrific. And Isaiah says, I'm going to see the travail of his soul. He saw what's going on. And the Father's justice says, but I'm going to be satisfied. And we got to stop. Oh, man, there's so much that I... Go to Romans 3:25. Now I'm thinking of having a part three. By the way, I'm not going to be here next Sunday. I'm going to be in Canada. Oh, Canada. But let's go to Romans 3, and we'll close it here. And Psalms 22 is a visual of the travail of our Savior's soul, okay, when he's hanging there. Don't reduce it to just blood and death, the agony, the horror of his personal experience because of you, okay? And again, God says, I do it because of my grace. Wow. That's why faith is the only response God can accept. How in the world can anybody even the audacity to say, but I've lived a good life? Are you, what? You lived a good life? Then why did I make my son sin? Why did I pronounce a curse on my dear son? Why did I blame him as the rebel? Why, you're saying, then I should have helped him when he was crying. See that? If you think your good works can merit even partial favor of Almighty God, you demean what Jesus experienced as his soul went through all of this travail. Romans 3:25, whom God hath set forth, here it is, he's out there for everybody to see, to be a propitiation, now notice, through faith in his blood. You see, through it all, you know why, as the Father sees the travail of his Son, and he says, I'm going to be satisfied by it, because by his knowledge, many shall be justified. The Father had the utmost confidence that his Son was going to go through it all, okay? He knew. He had confidence that his Son was going to go through it all. And we'll say some things next time about, well, what exactly is this faith in his blood, okay? Again, there's a personal transaction between dad and son. We're not part of it until a little bit later on. It's all done. And now the good news is God will give it to you for free as a gift. Father, we do thank you for your love and for your goodness. We thank you, Father, for that work that was done once and for all. We thank you, Lord, that you satisfied your offended justice, that you appeased your that violation of your righteousness when you personally gave your Son as that sweet-smelling sacrifice for all of our sins. Oh, Father, we just thank you for that reality. May we live with that renewed understanding, knowing that that is our reality. And to know that there's a whole lot more involved. You've actually declared us to be your beloved sons, and you've declared us to be blessed with all spiritual blessings, and you've declared that you're going to continually bestow upon us the kindness of the riches of your grace. Oh, Father, you're too good. And Lord, may that truth just continually encourage, motivate, and compel us to live as the sons that you've declared us to be. And, of course, we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.